So I will explain why film. This is what I'm going to be covering. The film format, the projection system itself, and some comments about infrastructure. I need to go forward. So, okay. There are 149,000 motion picture screens in the world, and about 20,000 digital projectors or digital projection screens in the world. And most of those, almost all of those, are stereoscopic. Those numbers change constantly, so I'm not sure how accurate it is. And you've got a lot of feature films. You've got something like 35 feature films in the next 12 months in 3D. So you can see this chart. Internationally, most of the cinema screens are in the rest of the world outside of the United States or North America. There's something like 37,000 theater screens in the United States. And you can see over here, you have digital projectors and 3D-enabled projectors. So there is a need, especially for cinema operators who or theater owners who can't afford a digital projector and the cost associated with the stereoscopic capability, because it can cost $150,000 over just a few years, combined with the cost of the projector, the server, licensing fees, and stuff like that. And there are a lot of people who can't afford that. I also would like to point out that I learned from reading in Scott Ehrman's The Speed of Sound, a book that covers the introduction of sound, that in the late 20s, half the theaters in the United States went out of business because they couldn't afford to be wired for sound. There were 45,000 theaters in the silent era, and half of those went away. The theaters that could afford to be wired for sound were all owned by the studios. It cost $20,000 to wire a theater for sound in the 20s, and the Western Electric got 10 cents a seat. That's a business model. It's remarkably similar to Realty's model. Here are some of the features. When I put the PowerPoint together, it was a couple of months ago. So these are the major features. They're independent features we don't know about. So it occurred to me and to other people, such as Technicolor, people at Technicolor, that you've got over 100,000 35 millimeter film projectors in the world. Isn't there some good way to use those to project in 3D? This is something that people have been trying to do for a century. What I'll cover now is the film format, the projection optics, and the infrastructure capability. All those things need to be addressed. First, I'll go back, and I'll talk about the format that had been used from the late 70s and 80s on. Maybe a dozen films were introduced in the early 80s using the above and below format. The above and below format took advantage of the entire, and I know that you're not film people, but the 35 millimeter format, which was introduced by Edison and Eastman, remained essentially constant for 100 years. So, but as sound was introduced, the optical sound area had to intrude into the picture area, and so over time, less and less of the frame has been available for picture, and so it had to be devoted to other information. But you can take in what's called the Academy frame, you can take two subframes, and you can, those would have an aspect ratio of the scope aspect ratio of about 2.4 to 1, and you can place them above and below each other, a left and a right, and then you can use optical means to polarize and combine them on the screen. It sounds great. But it has a flaw, which is actually a tragic flaw, because there's no known way to solve the problem. If you thread the projector improperly, the image will be projected pseudo-stereoscopically. And it's very easy to do. Not only that, when the reels are assembled, because motion pictures are now projected using a single projector, a single 35 millimeter projector, and the reels are assembled on a platter, so you take maybe 10 or 11 reels of film that are 1,000 feet each, and you splice them together, and when the kids in the projection booth, and literally I'm talking about kids because I've spent a lot of time in projection booths, when they look at the frame line, you can't tell the frame line from the subframe line, so you can assemble the film improperly. It's very, very easy to do. You can use index marks. You can do all kinds of things in order to solve the problem, but it's a problem that simply can't be solved. If you actually see that the image is being projected pseudoscopically and you attempt to correct it with the frame line control, the image will then be out of phase because the left image will have been captured 1/24 of a second before or after the right image. So it's a curious problem, and there's no cure. So what occurred to me was, and this is nothing in and of itself that's new, because people have been using side frames. So I figured, let's take the images, rotate them both through 90 degrees, and if we do that, we'll fill up the entire academy area. And it turns out that the images are intrinsically 1/8/5. There are two aspect ratios that are used generally for motion pictures, 1/8/5 and 2.4, 2.39 to 1. So this, that's gray area, here's the soundtrack, and here are the side frames. Because the side frames need to be rotated, you need some fancy optics, but because they're rotated in the same direction, their relative steadiness will be exactly the same. There'll be no unsteadiness between the left and the right side frame. So they're perfectly, relatively steady, but the intermittent of the projector will produce some unsteadiness. But the important thing is that both images move together. And the image is only 17% linearly smaller than 1/8/5. 1/8/5 was Universal's answer to scope, which was introduced by Fox in the early 50s. Scope uses anamorphic optics to spread the image to cover a wide screen, but Universal, I guess they didn't want to pay royalties to Fox, so they cropped the 35-millimeter Edison aspect ratio, which is about 1.37 to 1. They cropped it to 1/8/5 to 1. The 35-millimeter frame is 4 perfs high, but when you use the cropping method to achieve widescreen of 1/8/5, it's only 3 perfs high. So because 1/8/5 cropped is so inefficient because it uses so little of the, relatively little of the existing format, but you can actually rotate the 1/8/5 aspect ratio images, produce these side frames, and it's extremely efficient compared to the inefficiency of 1/8/5. So here's what the full aperture would look like, what widescreen would look like, and what the Oculus format looks like in terms of area. We had a devil of a time communicating to the people who need to produce the prints how to make this work. So I went back to the Society of Motion Picture Television Engineers' method of specifying dimensions, and then we had to translate these into digital, their digital equivalents. And so we had help at Photochem, and also with ARRI, so that any lab in the world that wanted to produce prints to this specification could do it. So it was, I thought it would be simple, but it turned out to be very complicated and hard. First, you need to produce a composite, a digital composite. The idea behind this is that you should be able to take any stereoscopic motion picture and project it using this system. So I want to show you that side frames have been used before. The Lumiere had a 3D format. I recently saw some of these movies projected in the Linwood Dunn Theater in Hollywood. But apparently Lumiere ran the camera and the projector horizontally. So they used, these frames are rotated through 90 degrees essentially, but really if the whole thing, if the whole system is designed to run horizontally, there's no optical rotation involved. And this was a 5-perf system, not a 4-perf system. So this was done in the, I think, in the late 20s or early 30s. So I'll now talk about projection. And I'll compare it to the Real DXL system, which recovers lost polarized light, uses a Z-screen or a liquid crystal modulator to change the characteristics of polarized light at video field rate. uses circular polarizing eyewear to analyze the images and a silver screen, a so-called silver screen, which is an aluminum painted screen, painted with aluminum pigment. And you need a server, you need a digital projector. For a 35 millimeter projector using the Oculus system is you need a new lens. You don't need to modify the projector. You need to tune up the projector and make sure that it meets SMPTE spec. And we chose linear polarizing eyewear because this is a budget system. Although the system is very high performance, it's going to be marketed to people who can't afford digital projection. And if you use linear, and if it was good enough for IMAX, I figured it was good enough for us, you can save a lot of money on the throwaway glasses. You can actually save something like 14 cents a pair because the linear polarizing material is a lot less expensive. Also, its extinction is much better than circular. It's probably an order of magnitude better than circular. In fact, it is. I measured it. And you can, if you, the photography is good, you can tip your head quite a bit. This is a, by inference and some calculation and some measurement, but it's kind of a hodgepodge, but it's just to give you a feeling for how this would work. The SMPTE spec for digital projection is 14-foot Lamberts. For 35 projection, it's 16-foot Lamberts open gate. That means there's no film in the projector, but it's assumed that you lose 2-foot Lamberts because of the base of the 35 millimeter print. You have a temporal duty cycle with field sequential projection, such as you have with a real D system or with expand or master image. So you've got to lose half the light because half the image has to go to, half the light goes to one eye, half goes to the other. That doesn't happen in the film projection system because both images are projected simultaneously. And the very efficient polarization recovery system in the XL system gets you back up to a lot of lost light. And I just calculated both are roughly equivalent. They're both very bright. And this is a remarkable result for a film projection system because it's almost getting two projectors for one. And the damn thing is it works. You need several optical stages. You need to form an image, so you need an image-forming lens. You need to rotate the images because you don't, people are not going to tip their heads on the side, and you can't rotate the projector. The images have to be registered properly on top of each other, obviously. The left and right images have to be within a certain specification, properly converged or superimposed, and the images, the left and right images, have to be polarized. So this is, these are the optics that do it. And after a lot of trial and error, and it's a very interesting problem, and I'll talk about it a little bit. So you have the image, you have the format up there at A, and then you've got an image forming lens at B, and then at C you have an optical path extender because the optics have to clear the front of the projector. And the optics take the form of a mirror unit with two paths. You've got inward-facing V-shaped mirrors at D and D prime. The light is reflected off of D onto E, and then to F, and through G, which is the polarizer. F and F prime are the converging mirrors. They rotate to get the images to be on the screen together, to converge the images. D and E rotate the images through 90 degrees. These are front surface mirrors. It's extremely efficient. We also use cinema lenses. Instead of using normal motion picture projection lenses, we use lenses that were designed for digital cameras that cover the full academy aperture, and they're a half a stop faster. Not only are they half a stop faster, or 50% faster, they're bright out to the corners. They have very good resolution. Also, we chose very efficient polarizers. We did tests, so we wound up with the equivalent of Polaroid HN38s instead of 32s, which are often used. And all of that added up to actually giving us my actual measurement in a half a dozen screening rooms in the Los Angeles area, over 10-foot Lamberts per eye through the polarizers. In other words, if you shot the screen through the eyewear, you'd get 10-foot Lamberts. And you'd do that on a 40 or a 60-foot screen with this system. That's what it looked like. That's the cowling of the front cover. I'll talk briefly about infrastructure, which for this crowd is probably important because mostly, you know, you're not film guys, but movies shot usually for theatrical release on film, but more and more they're being shot digitally. But it doesn't matter because those film images are turned into files. And those digital files become a digital intermediate, which is then turned back after post-production, is turned back into a film print after having made a negative. So we'd make a, in the case of the format I'm talking about, the Oculus format, we take a movie that's been produced either as a CG animated movie or a film or whatever it is. You do a side frame composite. In other words, you produce the side frames digitally. Then you do a film out. In the film out, you produce a motion picture negative. And from that negative, you can make probably up to 1,000 prints. And then you make your release prints. So we follow the infrastructure that's existed, the digital intermediate infrastructure. So that allows us to use pieces of technology that already exist in product forms. You don't have to reinvent everything. And without agreeing with the infrastructure, you can't have a product. It's timed like a 2D film release. There's no anti-vignetting required. There's no optical sweetening that's required. Although you could, if you want to make it look like a digital print, you could edge enhance. Thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. Well, yes. There's a question over there.
Testing. Thanks for your clear talk. And is there any special reason to use linear polarizing glasses instead of the ocular polarizing glasses? Because as far as I know, when you use linear polarizing glasses, when we move our head left or right side, I think the crosstalk is more severe.
Well, we tested it, and what you say is conventional wisdom. And it's because of Vivian Walworth and myself that most of the world today says what you said, because Vivian was the champion of circular polarization, and I listened to her. And all of the products that I've offered up until now use circular polarization. But this system was designed for people who, for theater owners who are not in the first tier, and I wanted to save them money. There's no reason why you can't use circular in this optical system, in this optical path. It will work just fine. But the test that we did absolutely convinced me that it was just fine. It worked very, very well indeed. Any other questions?
Yes, yeah. Next question here.
Oops. Yes, I'm sure there must be a good answer. I counted three reflections off of the mirrors. How's the left-right handedness is preserved?
How does the what get preserved?
Left and right handedness. Left and right.
Handedness?
Yes.
Okay.
With three reflections.
Well, it would be a lot to explain now, but it does work. It turns everything back around. It rotates the image through 90 degrees and does what it needs to do.
Is there any other questions, please? Do we have time for one more? John?
Well, it's hard to directly compare digital with film because the SMPTE spec for digital is 14 because you don't run any film in a digital projector. So essentially, it's comparing 14 foot Lamberts is the number for a film projector with a leader in it, with clear leader in it. Mm-hmm. And so the SMPTE standard is effectively the same for film and for digital.
All right.
They'd both be effectively 14-foot Lamberts.
Let's thank the speaker once more.
Thank you, Mike.